If you're not familiar with DARPA, what we do is we invite 100 people who are at the very, very top of their game, who want to do something big. They want to do something, give something back to make the world a better, safer, more secure place. And you're allowed to come for 4 years, and that's it, for 4 years. I usually run one or two programs, and they're usually in the order of roughly $50 to $70 million. I think Kathleen's talk is really apropos, because if you've been listening to everything at this conference, you're hearing a lot of excitement about the Internet of Things. And we've been excited about it for a while, but I think we've felt for a while that if we don't have a fundamentally new security model, we're not going to enjoy the Internet of Things. And we've launched four different programs to attack that. And I'm going to have Kathleen come up and talk about one of them. And I think it's certainly one we're excited about.
Thank you very much for that introduction. As Dan mentioned, I'm here to talk to you about Hackams, which is a DARPA program that funds roughly 100 top researchers from around the world. Those researchers are working on creating tools and techniques that will allow us to write software that's provably functionally correct and therefore invulnerable to large classes of attacks. Note that I did not say invulnerable to all attacks, just to certain classes of attacks. Why is this a super important problem? Well, the growing Internet of Things means that we have to worry about the security of a lot of devices and objects that don't look very much like computers. Everything from SCADA systems that control large critical infrastructure to medical devices, computer peripherals, communication devices, vehicles, and even everyday household objects, things like refrigerators and television sets. Researchers and/or attackers have shown that systems in each of these categories are actually vulnerable to remote attack. For example, Stuxnet showed that attackers can cross and reach even supposedly air-gapped systems and cause physical damage while hiding evidence of that attack from monitors. In 2011, Jerome Radcliffe reported at Black Hat that he was able to wirelessly hack into his insulin pump and cause it to deliver incorrect dosages of medication. Recent reports in the British press report that half the cars that were broken into in London this year were hacked electronically. Drilling down a little bit into the vehicle space, it helps to understand that a modern automobile is really a computer on wheels. Typical cars today are have somewhere between 30 and 100 embedded control units, which are essentially small computers connected via a number of networks. And since 2007, it's actually required by law to have a diagnostic port under the steering wheel so that mechanics can connect in and diagnose the system. Researchers at the University of Washington and the University of California at San Diego showed that if they could plug into that diagnostic port, they could rewrite all of the software in the car, making it do whatever they wanted instead of what the original manufacturer intended. That meant they had full control over the acceleration, over the braking, even over the locking of the car. The response to that first piece of work was actually somewhat muted, since if they were plugged into that diagnostic port, they were inside the car, and so already had physical control over the acceleration, the braking, and the locking. So they responded with a second piece of work, in which they showed that they could achieve exactly the same effect, taking over all the software in the car, without actually touching the vehicle in four different ways. They showed that they could put a virus on a computer in the mechanic shop and have that virus transfer to the car through that diagnostic port. They showed they could hack in through the Bluetooth interface. They showed they could break in through the cell phone service that's part of the car's telematics unit. And finally, they showed that they could craft a special version, electronic version of a perfectly ordinary song and play it in the car stereo and cause a buffer overflow that allowed them to achieve the same effect. Yeah, right, like even your car stereo isn't safe. Right, and the picture on the slide there shows how they were able to make the dashboard show that the car was going 140 miles an hour while in park. Right. So clearly we need a better approach to making cars secure, or more secure. So how are we going to do that? Well, the traditional approach for security for cyber-physical systems like automobiles is air gaps and obscurity. Unfortunately, neither of those approaches works very well anymore. Air gaps are pretty much the thing of the past for a number of really good reasons, actually. You want to be able to perform software updates. You want to be able to download diagnostic information. And manufacturers want to be able to provide new services. For these reasons, pretty much to a first approximation these days, all computers are networked. So air gaps are gone. The second approach was obscurity. Well, it turns out these kinds of systems aren't actually very obscure either. You can find out tons of information about them, often including passwords, just by simple Google searches. You can also easily buy prototype systems or example physical artifacts that you can then play with online. And then there's a plethora of tools that are available to help with the reverse engineering process. So basically, the systems aren't very obscure either. So another approach is to say, well, we have spent a lot of time developing security for desktop systems. Let's apply some of those desktop techniques. But that's not likely to work either for a couple of reasons. First of all, desktop approaches to security don't work very well even on the desktop setting. Antivirus detection systems, intrusion detection systems, those are looking for known vulnerabilities and are not very good, in fact, are useless against zero-day attacks. Also, security monitoring software is itself very complex software that can introduce vulnerabilities. For example, the chart on the slide that you probably can't read very well is the October 2010 DoD watch list of the top software vulnerabilities. The ones that have the red arrows, those are roughly a third of the vulnerabilities itself came from code and security monitoring systems. So they can be part of the problem as well as being part of the solution. The other problem with desktop solutions is that they're unlikely to translate well to the embedded system space. My laptop has two processors, one of which seems to spend full time scanning for viruses. That's sort of okay, because my laptop actually has an extra processor that we don't really know what to do with anyway. But in the desktop, in the embedded system space, that's just totally not the case. Extreme cost pressures means that processors in embedded systems are sized for the exactly for the expected workload, and we can't afford bigger processors. So these approaches are unlikely to work. We really need a fundamentally different approach to providing security for embedded systems. Right, so why are these systems so insecure? Well, it turns out there are many, many factors that go into it. Everything from buggy software, to malicious hardware, to unexpected side channels, to human error. That's, in fact, one of the things that makes security such a difficult problem, is that defenders have to worry about all those different kinds of things at the same time, while attackers just have to find one way in. The Hackams program is really just focusing on one aspect of the security problem, albeit an important one, namely the problem of buggy software that leads to vulnerabilities. The Hackams hypothesis is that we can pursue a clean slate, mathematically based approach to producing software that's provably functionally correct, and therefore provably invulnerable to large classes of attack. For example, we can prove that software written using formal methods is memory safe, and therefore invulnerable to the buffer overflow attacks that are the bread and butter of so many attackers. This slide gives a summary of three of the formal methods-based approaches that Hackams researchers are pursuing. The first is a code synthesis approach, where the compiler actually writes the code itself along with a proof of correctness from a high-level specification. In the second approach, developers write code in a domain-specific language rather than a general-purpose language like C++ or Java. The specificity of the language allows the compiler to ensure that the code does not have many common software vulnerabilities. In the third approach, developers write code and a proof of correctness at the same time in a theorem prover. This is the approach that has been followed to date to produce the most high assurance artifacts that exist in the world, specifically NICTA's SEO4 microkernel and INRIA's COMSORT verifying C compiler. Here, the key challenges are increasing the level of automation so that the computer can do more of the work rather than the person. To evaluate these ideas, Hackams researchers are writing software for four different vehicles. One of these vehicles is based on the Argicopter, which is an open source hobbyist UAV readily available on the web. To get a baseline assessment of the security of the platform, we gave the Argicopter to a professional red team that spent time trying to break into the system. They showed that it was, in fact, incredibly easy to break into the Argicopter. They could hijack it while it was in flight, disconnect the official operator from the system, and then fly it as if they were the official operator instead. In fact, we can replicate this demo for you today, so Pat Hickey is going to join me. He's one of the performers on the Hackams program. So to do that, we need to switch to the other laptop. And magically, it actually worked. Okay, so to get started, let me tell you what you're looking at. On the floor there is an Argicopter. It actually has two distinct radios, one of which connects to the pilot hand controller, which Pat is holding in his hands. The second radio is a two-way link that connects to the pilot's control laptop that's running flight control software. The hand controller is for low-level piloting kinds of commands, things that control the altitude, the pitch, and the roll, whereas the laptop flight controller is for high-level autonomy kind of controls, things like adding a waypoint to a flight plan. Because we're inside, there's no GPS, which means there's no GPS to keep the copter flying in a good place. So Pat's going to use the hand controller to make sure it stays flying in this kind of space here, not running into any of you or running into the walls. We're going to start out the system in the normal state, where the official operator is in full control of the system, both through the hand controller and through the laptop. When the attack happens, though, Pat's going to lose complete control of the vehicle, and the attacker, aka me with the laptop that's showing on the screen, will have complete control. Right, so the attacker, in order to make the attack, all we need is a radio that's stuck in my pocket. Radio that's exactly the same kind of radio that is in the pilot's laptop. And we need an attacking laptop, which is here. What's going to happen is from a communication signal point of view, the attacker radio is going to piggyback on the data link between the vehicle and the pilot's laptop. From the vehicle's perspective, it's not going to be able to tell the difference between this radio and the legitimate radio. So in stage one of the attack, I just plug in the attacker's radio to the attacker's laptop. And then you can see on the screen that the signal strength monitor now shows that I can now talk to the attacker can now talk to the quadcopter the same way that the legitimate pilot can. In the second stage of the attack, I'm going to push that performing attack button. And what the attack script that Pat nicely put together for me is going to do, it's going to send a stream of packets to the copter that will drown out any official commands that Pat is sending, because the stream from the attacking computer is going to send many, many more packets than the legitimate user is going to send. When it sends that stream of commands, one of the commands that it's going to send is an override command that tells the copter to ignore all commands from the official pilot. So when it sends that command, the quadcopter will stop listening to Pat, both the hand controller and the laptop controller. After sending that override command, it's going to tell it to land. And that's not a very dramatic command, but I could have told it to do anything else that the quadcopter could have done. If we'd been outside with GPS waypoint navigation, I could have told it to fly off into the sunset. Right, but we're just going to tell it to land. So when it starts to go down, that will be the attacker telling it to go down. Okay. Okay, so starting over again, we're unplugging the radio, plugging it back in again. So you could always tell it's a real live demo. Okay, there we go. So now I'm going to perform the attack. Oh, Pat has to take off now. Okay, so that's under normal operation. It's under Pat's control. When he nods that it's okay, I'm going to send the command to attack. Okay, so now we perform the attack, and now it's landing under my control. It's no longer under Pat's control. So this actual demo, I can reset it and return control to Pat. So I'm resetting it, so now Pat has control again. Right, so thank you very much for the demo. Right. So it's actually not at all surprising that the red team had an easy time hijacking the quadcopter. The designers, they had in mind easy connectivity. They wanted to make sure that somebody was always controlling the quadcopter, so they made connecting to it really, really easy. They had no model at all of having to defend against an attack, so the system lacks even basic rudimentary defenses. That's fine for hobbyist UAV, but unfortunately, it's the state of the art for many, many embedded systems. So what do Hackams researchers have been doing? Well, after 18 months, they've produced almost an entirely new quadcopter. They've replaced the computer hardware, and they've rewritten almost all of the software. Because of the extent of the changes, they've named their new system the Smackemcopter. There's actually an example of the Smackemcopter in the box over there, and Pat would be happy to give you a demo of the Smackemcopter flying after the presentations or later on in the morning. The Smackemcopter has almost all the functionality of the original ArduCopter, as Pat would be happy to demonstrate. It has stability control, altitude hold, direction hold. They're in the process right now of finishing up the GPS waypoint navigation to finish replicating the original functionality. They've also added DOS attack detection, so the system can tell if it's being jammed and then respond in a mission-specific way. To assess the security of the Smackemcopter, we gave the same red team full access to the system for 6 weeks, including full access to all the source code. At the end of that time, they were not able to break in wirelessly to the system, which is really an incredibly impressive result. Some of the technology that went into the Smackemcopter to make that possible include a real-time operating system that's been verified in a theorem prover, a domain-specific language that allows developers to write control system code in a way that's guaranteed to be memory safe, a high-level model of the system architecture from which we can synthesize glue code to connect all the pieces together, and a grammar-based filter that's guaranteed to drop all malformed messages from radios and third parties. The team proved a bunch of system-wide properties about the Smackemcopter using a tool that connects the proof of those properties down to low-level verified properties of the actual implementations. Some of those properties that they proved include memory safety and the fact that the Smackemcopter drops all packets that are either malformed or not authenticated from the ground station. They also proved that all well-formed authenticated messages that reach the copter will eventually be executed. My colleague at DARPA, who's actually a penetration testing expert, when he saw these results, his comment was that the Smackemcopter is probably the most secure UAV on the planet already, and we have, you know, 3 more years to go in the program. All of the code that, or almost all the code that's in the Smackemcopter is actually available online with an open source license. You can find it from the Smackemcopter website, which you can find easily by searching on Google, or if you can read really tiny fine print, it's in the bottom of the slide there. So we've actually made a lot of progress, but we still have a long way to go. We know how to build exquisite artifacts at a relatively high cost, things like the SCFO microkernel and the Comcert verifying C compiler. We also know how to leverage those artifacts to build larger high assurance systems, things like the Smackemcopter that we were just looking at. We need to make more progress, make that both require lower effort and lower levels of expertise. Those are difficult research challenges, but researchers are working on them and are likely to make really good progress in the next 10 years. That means that we have another new challenge, which is we have to figure out how to get these new tools and techniques that have been discovered transferred into practice so that developers can use them to make the Internet of Things more secure than the current state of the art. This is really an important problem because we want to make sure that our critical infrastructure, our medical devices, our cell phones, our vehicles, and even our like refrigerators and televisions are under our control, not under the control of the latest strain of malware. Thank you very much for your attention.